honorable audience, distinguished guests, and dear college, including my academic parents. It's an honor and a privilege to be here today to the inauguration of the Mexican Conference on Patent Recognition. This event represents a significant milestone as we return in a person MCPR edition following the COVID-19 pandemic. I am delighted to see so many college and friends, students, and researchers gathered here, ready to share knowledge, experience, and advances in the field of patent recognition over the next 4 days. Patent recognition is a fascinating discipline.
What is the question right now? Okay, professor, why is the university? Pero, si se ocupa para proyectar.
Yeah.
Basically, que marcó historia. Pues, pues nada. Invitado. Este, ahorita me parece que le mandé un mensaje a David. Voy a ocupar para esta memoria, crees una carpeta y descargues unos videos. Y de paso, si puedes por aquí ponerla a cargar. Ahorita te lo van a mandar, te lo van a mandar el mensaje por WhatsApp. Sí. Y descargar los archivos y los pasos de esa memoria. Si creas una carpeta, no sé que se llame. Es un nombre. Checar las cosas que son de nosotros por cualquier cosa, ¿no? Este, los archivos que lo voy a pasar a archivos a la hora. Van a pasar del enlace, es un drive y hay como unos 8 videos, los descargas y los pasas a la memoria
por el
también, ¿no? No, o sea, el drive que te mandé es el que te mandé, el enlace está en tu WhatsApp del rey. Ajá, te acabo de mandar este. Te acabo de reenviar el enlace. No, detalle, ¿no? Entonces. Bueno, el tuyo es el que está en. ¿Cuál? ¿En el trípode?
Sí.
Creo que lo puedes tomar. O sea, ahorita. Sí.
Bueno.
Sí, ¿sabes qué? No más se le baja, es como un switch. Si no, es así un momento.
Sí.
¿Tiene impresora? ¿Pasa con los archivos de video? Ah, ¿te lo mando? No. Ah, pues ahora lo mando por correo más fácil. ¿Es la tuya? A la verga.
Era con cosas. ¿Y no viste?
Sí.
Yo te digo.
Pero qué son, por qué me dijo que los imprimieron.
No sé si no es un video. ¿Un video?
Ajá.
Si le hiciste para que nos diera acceso, ¿no?
¿Solicitas el acceso?
Sí. En la pestaña de ayer. Cámbiale. A la última.
Voy, le dimos tras acá. ¿Qué le hiciste tú? El acceso.
¿Está bien?
Que no nos manda.
Ya le dije que no se escucha en el directo.
Yo ya le dije, está bien estresado por eso. Le dice, ¿sí se escucha? Y yo, pues se escucha, pero el que pero... Es que los micrófonos chicos de son los que están conectados a. Ahorita creo que tiene el audio, o sea, el micrófono de la tecla. Sí, pero igual está grabando el audio con su teléfono. No, o sea, tiene el audio de este.
Sí, porque me preguntaron si se escucha en directo y yo, pues no se han quejado ni nada.
dijo cosas. Ponte más en el audio. Con esta cámara, es que este micrófono trae el audio y el video. Lo compartimos porque es el video.
An approximation of the probability distribution. So this is called kernel density estimation. You use kernels, the Gaussian kernel is one of the kernels that I've used. So basically, the idea is to get the same complex probability, continuous probability distribution as a sum of Gaussians. Okay? So all idea, more than 50 years, okay, and this is still used today. Okay? Okay. See this equation here, that's important. This equation is here, and this is a derivation that I'm not going to elaborate, but I just want to give you an idea of how this is related to quantum mechanics or quantum computers. So this is kernel density estimation, that's the sum of Gaussians. Then you can approximate those Gaussians using something which is very well known in machine learning, which are random Fourier features, are approximations of a kernel such as the Gaussian using a finite approximation. So that's the idea that comes from the machine learning random Fourier features. And if you combine kernel density estimation and random Fourier features, you obtain this. And it happens that this is a density matrix, the same kind of density matrix that we use in quantum computer. And to calculate the probability, which is what you estimate with kernel density estimation, actually is an application of the boundary. Okay, so the thing that I wanted to show here, not really the details of the questions, but the fact that actually you can do estimation of continuous probability density functions using density matrices and the one rule, which are concepts of quantum mechanics. Okay, using this concept, we have been working on application in different contexts. These are recent papers. It was accepted like 1 month ago. Published on IEEE Access, and a method to do density matrix neural density estimation. Okay, so it's used density matrices, which is a concept from quantum computer, to do neural density estimation. Neural density estimation means models which are differentiable that you can integrate into other deep learning models. Okay. So these are examples which are like more graphical examples. You can apply to different kind of dimensions, but these are distributions in 2D. This first column is like the real distribution, the probability density function for real, from where the data is generated. This is the one produced by the method. This is the approximation. And these are baseline methods for neural density estimation. Neural density estimation is not an easy task. And you can see that at least here visually, this kind of approach works very well. And also, when you evaluate it using objective measures, you also see that there is an improvement. Okay? So this is one of the applications. The second application of this is to do learning, supervised learning. So basically, what we do is we modelate the training data. Which are, for instance, for a supervised learning problem, we have inputs and outputs. So we modelate like the state of the bipartite quantum system that has like one part that represents the X and one part that represents the Y, the labels. And then we represent all the this probability, joint probability distribution of outputs and inputs as a density matrices that summarize all the training data, and then we use that to do we do a quantum measurement to produce a probability distribution of the label. So more or less the process is as this sample, then we have the state of the system represented by a density matrix, we do a quantum measurement, and this produces a system where this is collapsed. And then we see what's the probability distribution of the Ys of the labels. And that probability distribution is represented by the density matrix. Okay, so this was a very general idea. We start from this idea and see if it works or not. Very inefficient initially, by the way. And the first paper that we published about this was in 2021. It was actually a paper that we published with in a journal of physics with my colleagues that are from the physics department in the National University. And basically what we did was to try to explore in very simple problems if this idea could work as a classifier. So this is the result, classifying the two moons data set. And it's very exploratory paper, but basically what we showed is that we have a representation which is quantum, that could be a mixed state or a pure state. It works very well, but if you have classical representation, it doesn't work that well. So basically it was like a proof of concept paper, but it was interesting from the point of view of, see, we can apply this concept of quantum mechanics to do machine learning, but it was not practical yet. It was very inefficient. So this is a paper that we published last year, where this is really a presentation of this framework from a machine learning point of view, where we present different models. So these are, you can think of as neural networks models, using those ideas of quantum measurement and density matrices. So this is differentiable. You can integrate with other deep learning models. And when we have models for doing density estimation, for doing classification, and for doing regression. And this is practical, we can use in our own models, and we can have some advantages of using them. But basically the idea here was to show an efficient implementation of this idea that you can use in machine learning models, okay? Okay, this is part of our last work, this is a preprint. But I want to show you what would be the advantage of using this. So actually here what we are proposing is a deep learning framework, so that is probabilistic. So the promise here is that you can use this framework to do deep learning, but having probabilities, which is very important. There are different ways to involve probabilities in deep learning frameworks, but you have some advantages and disadvantages. So this is the kind of thing that you can do with this quantum kernel vision framework. So in the top part, you see a conventional classifier, for instance, to classify digits. So you have an encoder, which is deep, and then you represent the output of the encoder that is representing the input image as a density matrix. In this case, it's a density matrix with only one component. And then you perform inference. The inference is based on a density matrix that represents the joint probability distribution between the input and the output, which are the labels. In this case, if we are classifying a digit, this is just an example. So this is the joint probability of images and the label of the digits. And then you apply inference, which is a quantum inference, to get a prediction, okay? So this is a conventional classification model. Which is interesting about this is that you can train the top part. Basically, training means learn this joint probability distribution, and you can learn it simultaneously while you learn the encoder. It is a deep learning model. And then you learn this joint probability distribution, and the interesting thing is that you can use in the opposite way. You can give the label, and actually you can make a probability distribution of the labels. Use this joint probability, apply inference, and get a probability distribution of the inputs, okay? So this is a probability distribution of images. You do sampling, apply the decoder, and then you get a generative model from a discriminative model, okay? So you train it discriminative, it learns to classify, but then after training, you can use it to as a generative model, okay? This is very particular. There are not many models in deep learning where you can do this kind of reversal, okay? So that's an advantage of using this approach. Our focus is mainly on algorithms, which are classical algorithms that you can run in classical computers that have this kind of quantum inspiration. However, part of our work is to try to see how we can implement this also in quantum computers. And because of the quantum formulation of the algorithm, it's not difficult to make like an implementation in a quantum computer. So this is an example of a toy problem. It's the kind of problem that you can run in nowadays quantum computers that we have access to. This is the simulation of the quantum computer, and you can see these are the samples and the regions behind the color represent the classifier. So, the model here definitely learns to classify. This is a noisy simulation. It's a simulation of a quantum computer that takes into account noise. And this one is the algorithm running in a real quantum computer that you can access to IBM Quantum Initiative. It's a 5 qubits computer. It happens to be called IBM Bogota, but it's not because we have a quantum computer in Bogota. It's because IBM gives names of cities to his quantum computers. And when we run this, it was a coincidence that it got to run in this computer in Bogota. So, and this is the output from a real quantum computer doing classification. Okay, so it's interesting to see. It's interesting. However, this is more on practical. The practical interest, at least not now, but it's interesting to see that we can make this kind of algorithms to work in this very limited quantum computer that we have access to. Okay. So, what are the take-home messages from this talk? First message: quantum computer definitely is interesting, important. A lot of resources are invested nowadays on quantum computer. Many people is saying that it's going to be the next big thing. We don't know. If you ask me, I would say probably we will not see that in the next 5 or 10 years. What I suspect, but it's difficult to know because you receive like conflicting messages from one side or the other. But it's important to an absolute, definitely. Second, the intersection between machine learning and quantum computer definitely is very interesting. Okay, so it's a very interesting intersection. The fact that we don't have yet a quantum computer, a practical quantum computer, doesn't mean that we cannot research in that intersection. As I was mentioning at the beginning, for instance, the intersection of neurophysiology and computing that brought us neural networks was interesting per se, okay? Even if the practical use of that was going to be seen 40 or 50 years after that. So, from an intellectual academic point of view, this is very interesting. Okay. However, definitely we have options, and then we can do quantum accelerator. So algorithms that can run in quantum computers, but that we cannot apply to solve practical problems yet, or we can do quantum inspired. I think this is a safer bet to do quantum inspired. Why? Because actually, you can get very interesting things from quantum mechanics and quantum computing that you can apply to classical algorithms to get some advantages solving practical problems. And then this is definitely something that you can see the result right now. But at the same time, you are working with quantum, you are getting familiar with quantum, and then if this becomes a reality soon, we are going to be better prepared for that new revolution of quantum computer if it happens. Okay, so I think this is a safer bet, but it's what I think right now. Probably in 1 year I will change my mind, but right now I think it's safer to work in quantum inspired. Okay, okay. So this is done with my students and other collaborators from other groups. So here is a short list of some of the people that have collaborated to this. And this is what I wanted to tell you. I used to put this is from a movie. The scene here is from a movie that I like. It's Death Sentence is the name, and it's from the 50s. And I like because actually they talk about the conflict of a company where they install a computer that is going to replace people there, and they talk about information retrieval in the victims. I like to do that. But, and I have been using this for a while, because it has the end there. But later, actually last week, I saw the first quantum computer in a movie, actually not in a movie, in a series. This is from a series in Netflix, which is called Black Mirror. And this chapter appeared last week. It's called John is Awful, and she's trying to destroy the quantum computer there. And this is Salma Hayek here. Okay, thank you very much. Didn't explain many details about it. As I was saying, density matrix is like the main formalism to represent the state of a quantum system. It combines both quantum uncertainty that you have in a wave function in a vector, but also it represents a classical uncertainty. So that's something which is interesting, that you can like two kinds of uncertainty in quantum mechanics, okay? So that's the formalism, that's the basis of everything. The problem with density matrix is that they are squared on the dimension of the space, so that's very inefficient. So an explicit representation of density matrix would be costly. So what we have done later is use kernels, the same kernels which are used in, for instance, support vector machines. So really what we are doing is like an implicit representation of the density matrix. And so we don't have to represent it explicitly. And the advantage is that actually we can represent density matrix in infinite spaces. When we use a Gaussian kernel, the corresponding space is in infinite dimensional. So that's the approach, using kernels. So the answer is using kernels.
Other questions?
Thank you for the presentation. I have a question. I'm working with convolutional neural networks.
Right.
And actually, it's categorical. Neural networks is defining. Black box.
Uh-huh.
And my question is related to this. If programming a neural network in quantum computer, for example, is possible to explain better that classical neural network?
Yeah, good question. And the answer is that really is going to be more complex and more difficult to explain. However, yeah, I would say that there are quantum neural networks, proposals of quantum neural networks, and really it doesn't improve the interpretability of neural networks. So neural networks are very simple, the elements are very simple, but when you have a neural network with millions of connections, millions of ways, it's very difficult to know what's going on there. However, in the quantum-inspired approach, it happens that the way that this works, or at least the way that we have made it work, you can think of your model as a model based on prototypes. So the way that you represent
the information, the model, the interactions between inputs and outputs is based on prototypes. So the fact that you have prototypes, that gives you some interpretability. Because when you show, for instance, an image, an input image to one of these models, and it goes to a deep neural network, actually at the end what happens is that you compare with different prototypes, and you can see which prototypes are the ones that you use to do your classification. And then you can use those two prototypes to do interpretation to say, see, I classify this image as a file because it is similar to this file, and this file. Something like that. So, yeah, you can have some sort of interpretability thanks to the fact that this is based on prototype, but it's not because of the quantum, but it's because of the way that it is implemented. Okay, any other question?
Thanks a lot for the talk, it was very interesting. And my question comes from a different angle. Who do you think is going to be responsible of taking care of the development of this AI in the next future, the near future? I mean, would it be people that come from theoretical physicists and learn algorithms, or people that know algorithms and have to learn more mathematics and more physics? And at which level shall we, the universities, start doing it? Can it, of course, go a PhD, master's, or even start at least at a certain level in the bachelor? Thanks.
Yeah, good question. So, yeah, the problem of working on these intersections is that you need to know from both, I mean, it depends how many areas you are combining, but in this case, for instance, quantum mechanics, quantum computer, and machine learning, you need to have like a background in both, in principle. I would say that really for somebody working either in computing and learning about the physics, or somebody working on physics and learning about the computing, is the effort is basically the same, and I wouldn't say that anyone has an advantage. However, I have to say that I have seen many people from physics working like data scientists, machine learning engineers, and they are very good. And the reason is because they have a very strong background in mathematics, statistics, probability, and also they are very good at modeling, which is very important when you do this. So I will say that that is important independently of where you are, if you are from engineering or you are from physics. So a very strong foundation on physics, I would say mathematics more than physics, mathematics, statistics, computing is very important. However, really the mathematics of this is linear algebra and probability. Quantum mechanics has like a bad name because they tell you, don't try to understand because you are not going to understand. If you think that you understood it, it's because you didn't understand it. So is that's a famous quote from Feynman. However, the mathematics is not that complex. So it's linear algebra and probability, basically. So yeah, I would say that we need a strong foundation in the mathematics and computing and statistics, but in engineering, generally, you have that basis. Okay. Any other question?
Final question.
Please.
Well, thank you for your talk. Currently, people is scared about artificial intelligence.
Yes.
And maybe quantum computing is going to increase this.
Yes.
So do you know, or do you expect some new regulation about the use of quantum computers if they exist? If they exist, some.
Yeah.
Do you expect some regulation, or do you know about some kind of regulation to be prepared for quantum computers?
Yes, that's right. In fact, what I would expect is that thanks to what is happening in artificial intelligence, there is more consciousness about the importance of having regulations for this kind of technology. Definitely, a quantum computer may have some particular impact. However, there is a difference. I would say that probably we are in the. I would say for quantum computing is easier than for artificial intelligence in the sense that you really need a lot of resources to have a quantum computer. Nowadays. However, there is a strategic game. So what I perceive is that USA and Europe are more advanced on the quantum computer part. China is more advanced in quantum telecommunications, in quantum cryptography, is what I know. However, there are risks, and it is possible that this could amplify the risks that we already have with machine learning. However, I would say that probably what is happening nowadays with artificial intelligence is going to have repercussion on this kind of technology. I hope, because I really think that we are really in trouble if we don't regulate quickly what's happening in artificial intelligence. This is going to give us a little more time. I don't know how much, but. Okay, so thank you very much for your attention.
Well, now formally, we want to give a gift from the organizing committee and provided also by the Secretary of Terms of Nairobi. For your time, for chair, your experience and expertise with all about
thank you.
This topic.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation.
Beautiful.
Now to continue with the program. We have a coffee break, but please take few minutes in order to hold.